Hello viewers, welcome to the session on interior space design. In this session, we are going to study the topic furniture, lighting, window treatments and accessories. We will try to gain better understanding of the principles of interior designing, gain knowledge to provide adequate facility for work, relaxation, rest, comfort, privacy, maintenance and aesthetics, etc. through interiors. Gain better understanding of joinery, workmanship, etc. Understand the application of anthropometric measurements in space designing for various activities. Let us start with the introduction. Interior design is the art and science of understanding people's behavior to create functional spaces within a building. In interior design, arranging the basic layout of spaces with the elements like furniture, lighting and accessories require an understanding of technical issues such as window and door positioning, acoustics and beauty. Furniture, lighting and accessories are a powerful design tool in decorating. And interior design, which is the art of composition and coordinates these three elements together to create a stylish scheme. Designers should have knowledge about the psychological effects and meaning of each element to create suitable combinations for each place. Combining these three elements together properly also gives a certain state of mind and has positive and negative effects. They make a room feel more calm, cheerful, comfortable or dramatic. They also make a tiny room seem larger or smaller. So, it is important to choose appropriate furniture, lighting and accessories for a place in a way people want to look and feel in the space. Let us now study joinery and carpentry. To begin with, joint. A joint can be defined as connecting and uniting together two pieces of wood. This means two wooden pieces are not only connected together but also united. That is, they act as one piece for all practical purposes. Joinery. It is the method by which different pieces of wood are attached and is often an indication of the quality of a piece of furniture. The manner in which separate members of a chair, table or chest are attached to each other reflects strength of construction as well as appearance. Some of the most common types of joinery used in furniture construction. Types of joints. Butt joint. One piece is cut flat with the end grain meeting the side grain of the other piece of wood. Butt joints can be used to make corners or to attach pieces of wood at a horizontal midpoint on another piece of wood. Glue alone is not always enough to reinforce a butt joint. The big disadvantage of a butt joint is that it is relatively weak. Second one is mitre joint. A mitre joint is a joint made by beveling each of two parts to be joined, usually at a 45 degree angle, to form a corner, usually a 90 degree angle. It is often used in making picture frames. The third one, tongue and groove joint. The tongue and groove method is resorted to for joining boards of any required length along their edges, such as or required further backboarding necessary in such pieces of furniture as bookcases, cupboards. In grooving and tonguing, special match planes are required. These planes go in pairs, one forming the tongue by cutting away to a fixed extent the wood on each side of it and the other sinking the groove to receive the tongue. The fourth one is rabbeted joint. A rabbet, also known as rebate, is a recess or groove cut into the edge of a piece of machine, table material, usually wood. When viewed in cross-section, a rabbet is two-sided and open to the edge or end of the surface into which it is cut. The fifth one is dovetail joint. A dovetail joint, or simply dovetail, is a joint technique most commonly used in wooden working joinery. The dovetail joint is commonly used to join, for example, the sides of a drawer to the front. A series of pins cut to extend from the end of one board interlock with a series of tails cut into the end of another board. The pins and tails have a trapezoidal shape. Once glued, a wooden dovetail joint requires no mechanical fasteners. The sixth one is mortise and tenon. Simple and strong, the mortise and tenon joint has been used for thousands of years by woodworkers around the world to join two pieces of wood, usually when the pieces are at an angle close to 90 degrees. The end of the first member is called the tenon, and it is usually narrowed with respect to the rest of the piece. The hole in the second member is called the mortise. The joint may be glued, pinned, or wedged to lock it in place. The seventh one, dowel joint. A dowel is a solid cylindrical rod, usually made of wood, plastic, or metal. In its original manufactured form, dowel is called dowel rod. Let us now study hardware fittings and fastenings for furniture. A fitting is a small detachable part on or attached to a piece of furniture or equipment. The method used for joining wood will depend on the function, strength, and quality of the product. Wood joints can be made with screws, nails, glues, and knockdown components, or with frame joints such as butt joints, halving joints, mortise and tenon, dovetail, and box joints. Screws, nails, hinges, and bolts and nuts used in fitting furniture. A fastener is a hardware device that mechanically joins or affixes two or more objects together. In general, fasteners are used to create non-permanent joints, that is, joints that can be removed or dismantled without damaging the joining components. Welding is an example of creating permanent joints in furniture. Let us now study window treatments. Window is an important wall element in a building, as they let in light, airflow, view, and add elegance to the structure. Treatments are functional covering to windows to protect privacy, insulate heat and cold, and filter light and enhancing their aesthetic qualities. They blend the exterior and interior in a harmonious manner. Window treatments are more than a decorating decision. They are for solving many practical problems. Typically, a perfectly planned window needs no treatment. Some windows require an additional consideration based on the window's architecture. Let us now look at the types of window treatments. Windows can be aesthetically transformed by adding simple decorating touches to exterior and interior. These decorations can also help to control energy costs and provide different types of home security as well. Depending on the overall budget and desired end result, there are many options on how to decorate windows through both interior and exterior treatments. Let us first of all look at the exterior treatments. Exterior window treatments have one overriding advantage. They provide the most effective climate control without interfering with furniture or taking wall space within the room. Exterior treatments could effectively control undesired elements surrounding the building in a more aesthetic way. They are awnings, shutters, cutouts, and projecting elements, plants, grilles, and fences. Metal roll-down shutters, solar shades, lovers, etc. The next one is interior treatments. Hard window treatments include many other kinds of controls such as shades, blinds, screens and shutters. These treatments can move sideways or up and down, the latter having the definite advantage of being completely out of the way when not wanted. They are more rigid and architectural by nature and may be better for certain situations than the traditional soft window treatments. Soft window treatments are defined as being purely decorative in nature. The one exception is functional draperies, which open and close to cover your entire window or windows, are sliding glass doors. There is a small selection of ready-made draperies which can be purchased at specialty or department stores. However, they are generally single panel draperies, generally sold in three standard lengths. These are good for small windows or decorative purposes only. These types of fully lined draperies are the one exception of a soft window treatment being completely functional. Soft window treatments can finish a room by adding aesthetic warmth, infusion of color and pigment, texture, patterns in fabric, coordination for the room and sound absorption. Examples of soft window treatments would include lined drapery, side panels, whether they are plain panels with rod pockets or pleat panels, or having trims or other interesting add-ons to introduce an interesting focal point to the room, swags, cascades, etc. Now going to study shades. Shades are pull up and down and are mounted on rollers. They may be mounted at either the top or bottom of the window, unwinding either downward or upward. Shades reduce light and give privacy in direct relationship to their thickness and translucency or opaqueness. They may be constructed of vinyl or fabric and may be reflective to reduce heat gain. A fabric used elsewhere in the room can be laminated into a plain shade to give unity and individuality. Roller shades are expensive. Gather shades. While performing in the same manner as roller shades, have a very different mechanism for raising and lowering them. Varieties are bamboo or matchstick and woven wood, pleated shades, honeycomb pleated and others. Blinds. Colonial homes used Venetian blinds made of wood, but they are available in metal and plastics as well. Their special advantages include almost complete light and air control directed straight into the room, down toward the floor or up toward the ceiling, as well as complete disappearance behind a valance or other treatment if desired. Blinds are durable and not expensive unless made of wood. They create pleasing horizontal lines. Some common varieties are Venetian blinds, vertical blinds, mini and micro blinds. Curtain. Curtain is a piece of cloth intended to block or obscure light or drafts or water in the case of a shower curtain. A curtain is also the movable screen or drape in a theater that separates the stage from the auditorium or that serves as a backdrop. This is sometimes called as drapery, a general word referring to cloths or textiles used for decorative purposes such as around windows. Curtains are a form of window treatment and complete the overall appearance of the house. Window treatment helps control the ambience and flow of natural light into the room. The effect of drapery or curtains is best seen in daylight and with proper indoor light positioning can look attractive even at night. Treatments could be to solve a single problem or tackle multiple issues. Selection of light filtering blinds as window treatments may include a valance or window topper to soften the lines or to add color. Also, a window may be treated with more than one layer of aesthetic treatment to create a dramatic effect. More layers of treatments may include a room darkening shade to filter light at certain times of day with shears to let light in at other times. Topping this arrangement might be with drapes made from luxurious fabric. Let us now have a look at lighting in interiors. Lighting or illumination is the deliberate use of light to achieve a practical or aesthetic effect. Lighting includes the use of both artificial light sources like lamps and light fixtures, as well as natural illumination by capturing daylight. Lighting is an important aspect of interior design as it enhances the aesthetic appeal and creates the mood and ambience of a living space. Lighting fixtures that illuminate a room creates a safe and comfortable environment, besides adding style to the interior decor. Light is the main element that gives the room a special look and transforms it into a seamless combination of functionality and style. Besides playing a functional role, it creates a visually dynamic space. Lighting can make or break the ambience of a room. Hence, proper lighting is an important element of decorating your homes. Let us now study the uses, advantages of good lighting. The first one is clear visual perception of object and surroundings. The second, increased efficiency. The third, better appearance. The fourth, reduced accidents. Better utilization of time by not depending on direct sunlight. The sixth, high reliability and continuity. And the last one, seventh, reduction of eye strain and better health of the inhabitants. Now also look at the types of lighting. How many types of lighting do we have? Based on purpose. The first one is general or functional or background lighting. It provides a soft level of light throughout an area. For example, living rooms and bedrooms, halls, stairs and landing areas. The second, focal or task or local lighting. It provides adequate illumination for the various jobs about the home. Example, lighting up kitchen, food preparation surfaces, cooker, sink and laundry area in bathroom, for shaving and doing makeup in bedroom, for dressing tables and reading in bed, in dining room, above the dining table, in living room, for reading purpose, etc. The third one is decorative or ornamental or ambient or accent lighting. Used to shape the room or draw attention to a particular area, emphasize a collection of beautiful objects to illuminate a painting, plants, statue, etc. Now also look at the types of lighting based on direction. The first one, diffused lighting. It emits light in all directions. Normally, any incandescent and fluorescent lamps without any shade provide diffused lighting. The second one, direct lighting. It emits 90% of the light downwards to a specific location. For example, hanging fixtures used above the dining table or in the center of a kitchen. The third one, indirect lighting. It provides 90% of the light in upward direction, that means towards ceiling and upper side of the walls. The fourth one, semi-direct lighting. It provides 70% light downward and 30% upward. It is mainly placed on the walls to enhance their beauty. The fifth one, semi-indirect lighting. In this case, 70% light will be going upward and the rest of 30% light will be falling downward. It is also used on the walls. Selection of lighting. Type of lighting to be used in a room depends on the type of activities carried on in the room, which of course varies from one family to another. Light is measured in terms of foot candles. Foot candle is the lumen per square foot, the quantity of light spread for one square foot. An ordinary candle spreading light in all directions will spread the lumen per square foot on a surface held 1 foot away from it. The lighting in a home changes the mood of a room just as it does the perceived size of a room. Placement and type are important aspects of interior design, and they work in conjunction with color selections, room size, availability of natural light, and furniture selection. The elements that come together when the right lighting is achieved transform a room into a smooth combination of functionality and style. Well, there are some concepts that are used in selection of lighting. Let us first look at color management. Darker colors make a room feel smaller and cramped, while light-colored walls do the opposite. The illusion of space is defined by light reflected off of the surfaces of the walls. Some types of lighting help with this illusion by further illuminating the walls. In addition, directional lighting such as a track light can soften the wall colors. Recessed lighting has a soft downward glow that illuminates the floors, not walls. Lights hung from the center of the room provide ambient illumination or wall lighting. Directional lighting. The lighting in a room either provides illumination for the total room or it highlights specific elements. Track lighting is the perfect example of positional lighting. Hung from the ceiling, the adjustable necks and lamps can be pointed at specific elements such as a wall painting, the vase of flowers on an entryway table, or the bar top or kitchen island. Consider mounting them on the walls also. Recessed lighting can be used in floors and ceilings to create vertical beams of light. Functionality. One major role of lighting in the interior setting is functionality. Lighting needs to serve a purpose or it simply wastes electricity. Chandeliers are not only used in large open foyers, entryways and rooms because of their centrally themed placement, but also because they provide excellent illumination for the room. Wall lights add length and size visually to an entryway hall as well as light the way. Consider the style of lighting one wants to ensure to get the best directional or luminescent type for the setting. Task-specific lighting for desks and other work areas where functionality is more important than overall room illumination. Space. Both natural and man-made lighting help with the illusion of space. For a darker room, find ways to bring in more full-spectrum natural light. If the room does not have sufficient lighting, it will feel cramped. This is worsened by close proximity furniture arrangements such as coffee table, end table, sofa, chair, and love seat combinations in a smaller setting. Corner lamps, wall sconces, and centrally hanging lights on the ceiling help brighten a room if natural lighting is not available and help create a visually larger space. Natural lighting is preferred above man-made lighting because it shows off colors better and adds to the visual space of a room by bouncing off reflective surfaces. Consider skylights or large windows if one wants more natural light, or use sheer drapes and curtains to allow the maximum amount of light from the windows. Arrangement and care of lighting fixtures. Arrangements of spaces should relate their lighting needs in order to establish a procession. This also helps the designer figure out how to relate private and public programs for the building. Public and private spaces are often grouped together, but they can also be arranged to complement each other. Make a general bubble diagram of lighting needs of spaces and how they relate to each other. Well, some of the guides for lighting selection. Let us look at them. The first one, ceilings. Ceilings should be light in color but not glossy, because glossy ceilings create glaring. When lighting is provided in any room, consider beauty, function, and safety. Entrance. Entrance should have a fixture placed at either side of the door or above it to direct light on the steps and on the faces of visitors. There should be at least one light in a room that can be controlled by a switch at the entrance. If there is more than one entrance, light should be controlled at each entrance. Living room. Illumination levels should be 7 to 8 foot candles to 25 to 30 foot candles. It should have general lighting and local lighting for reading, sewing purposes. Bedroom. A central fixture is essential for general illumination to view the things and to clean the room. Additional lighting is needed for reading in bed and putting on makeup. Dining room. The table is the central point of interest. Light should be provided above the table by using ceiling mounted chandeliers or pendant lighting. Bathroom. It can have one general light on wall or ceiling and one local light above the mirror. Kitchen. It requires the even distribution of light specifically on work areas like sink, range and work surfaces. It can also have one general lighting and two or three local lights above sink, stove and work surface. Care of lighting fixtures. Routinely wipe the exterior surface of lighting fixtures with a soft, clean cloth. Doing so will help to get the maximum amount of light out of each fixture and avoid wasting energy. Use glass cleaner to keep the glass clean and clear. Car wax can be used on the metal surface to preserve and protect the finish of the lighting fixture. Applying twice a year can help in keeping the fixtures clean and bright. We are now going to study accessories, meaning, definition and types. The meaning and definition of accessories. Home accessories are furniture items which are easy to replace and easy to move and include almost any items that are not strictly functionally necessary in the decorated space. These items are commonly used in indoor furnishings and layout and can include cloth items, paintings and plants. Examples include such items like lanterns, wall hangings, mirrors, photo frame, gel fire, lamp bases, etchings, collectibles, curtains, sculptures, etc. These are movable decorations, reflect the owner's taste and create a personal atmosphere where they are placed. These items can break the boundaries of traditional decoration industry. Using handicrafts, textiles, collectibles and things such as lamps, floral items and plants recombined to form a new concept. Home accessories vary according to size and shape of room, space, the owner's living habits, hobbies, tastes and their economic situation. Well, a thing which can be added to something else in order to make it more useful, versatile or attractive is the definition of accessory. Types of accessories. There are two types of accessories. The first one, functional accessories. A functional accessory serves a purpose and also has aesthetic value. For example, pictures, clocks, bookends, candle holders, photo frames, small vases, lamps, mirrors, floor arrangements, napkin holders, etc. Functional accessories should be beautiful and decorative. The second one, decorative accessories. Decorative accessories are not functional but are used to give an aesthetic look to the home. For example, sculpture, photo frame, showpieces, wall hanging, pot holder, etc. We will now try to study the selection and placement of accessories. The selection and placement of accessories in a room are usually the most enjoyable parts of decorating. Procuring the accessories in the interiors and exteriors of the house and their arrangement completes one's style. As told earlier, accessories can be either functional or decorative, with some being both. For instance, one could hang baskets on the wall, decorative, and then use them for displaying fresh fruit or for organizing magazines, functional. Functional accessories usually serve a specific purpose or need. Examples include clocks, mirrors, pillows, vases, table lighters, lamps, books, spices in a kitchen, or bowls of fruit. One should take extra care to choose attractive functional accessories. This is especially important in small spaces, since functional accessories may have to carry the entire load of finishing or completing the room. Decorative accessories are those that one can choose for their beauty alone. Plants and flowers, paintings, photographs, sculpture, handcrafted items, and collections play an important part in enriching our home and the inhabitants' spirits. A home without any decorative objects would be almost like a world without sound. The decorative accessories you choose help to set a mood and to make a statement. In an interior, accessories should be placed judiciously in relation to the existing group of furniture. Lamps, pictures, etc. They should not disrupt but support the emphasis already present. They should be arranged in original and interesting ways. One should see that the most important accessories in a room should be the center of interest. We should not forget some of the points that are to be considered in selection of accessories. The first one, expressiveness. The second, proportion. The third, style. The fourth, balance. The fifth, placement. And the last, the sixth one, is color. Well, so far we have seen and studied the lesson about different types of joints and fittings that are used in the construction of furniture. Apart from the furniture, the other items like lighting and the window treatments, which add more aesthetic look to the interiors of the house, are learnt. The items that are used for the decoration purpose are accessories, which are used for at the final stage of the decoration, were also dealt in this lesson. Understanding the importance of the three elements, that is furniture, lighting, and accessories, and combining them together properly is important for making an interior look beautiful. Well, I trust that the session on this interior designing and windows and the other lighting that we have seen so far have been useful and resourceful to all our viewers. Thank you.